August 22nd, 2024, regular meeting of the Manchester-Shortsville School District Board of Education. Everyone please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic which stands on one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. So, at this point, we've got something a little bit different here, you guys. We're going to go ahead and approve the meeting agenda. To me, this really just represents the idea that this group all agrees that no one feels like there's something that's not in this meeting that should be, or vice versa. Honestly, I don't know that we really need to do a formal vote, but I think we might as well go ahead. It's okay with me. How do you guys feel about that?
Yes.
No need to do that.
Approving the agenda.
Because you set the agenda.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, on behalf of all of us, the goal would be that if we're communicating well, and you're expecting something there, it should be there, and you've had time as well to see. So.
Well, and the whole point was not to have it like last meeting, where we're adjusting everything in the middle of the meeting. We made a lot of agenda changes in the middle of the meeting when we pulled personnel out. So if we're going to do that, we should do that at the start of the meeting.
I'm okay if these guys are with the idea that I think we're at a point now where we know that if someone knows ahead of time they want something to change, that they should be hopefully comfortable at the beginning of that, right?
This month is a lot.
And if you do have something in the meeting, I want to just be clear. It's like, that's not disallowed. Like, that's fine. I hope that's an extenuating circumstance. Tim, I think what we're going to do, unless you know of a reason we need to take a vote on the agenda, we'll just acknowledge the agenda and go forward.
Okay. I think it's a motion, I think you change it.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, if you want to change it, you can move to amend the agenda.
Sure.
Okay, so I'll just take a moment to acknowledge the agenda, and if there's any questions or concerns, that's good. That brings us to, and by the way, let me ask, is everyone feeling okay about board docs? Navigating board docs?
The only issue I had is when my internet was out.
Oh, your internet was out?
That's
going to
be
fine. Did you get a chance? Your preferred, yeah, okay. That was the thing, right? It's not like it's being forced, and so once you get comfortable, you're good. All right, so, very good. Well, I'm glad we talked to Bart at work, Tim, or whatever. Okay, so then the next thing on our agenda is the July 2nd regular meeting minutes. So the board, upon the recommendation of the superintendent pursuant to education law, approves the July 2nd, 2024 regular Board of Education meeting minutes as presented. Motion from Chelsea, thank you very much, and a second from Scott. If you guys noticed, you clicked the little link. I actually thought it was pretty slick the way the minutes pop up there. I mean, you're still working on it. But you guys, did you get a chance? It's pretty easy to review. Any questions before we go? Cool. All right. Are you good?
I'm good.
All right, cool. All in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you very much. All right. And then that takes us to do we have public comment?
No, I just goes to the board docs.
Okay.
Switch now.
Okay, so yeah. Bear with us, folks. We're new process. Do we have public comment?
No public comment.
No public comment. Okay. Very good. All right. So. Tim, is that supposed to update? So to me, when I see under meeting opening, I get down here minutes of July 2nd regular, then it goes into public comment. Is that to me?
Yeah.
We approve prior meeting minutes before we do public comment? Is it normally work?
That was, most schools approve the agenda and the public comment, or last meeting at the same time.
Okay.
A lot of schools actually approve the minutes and sent agenda, but we're not there yet.
All right. Sorry, guys. So yeah, all right, well, we'll go ahead then and comment, we don't have any presentations, and Chris has an update for us.
Yep. So I know we have been talking, and there's been a lot of conversation about our continued rebrand, so I thought tonight would be a good time to provide a little update regarding this. And as the board knows and folks know, we have two board members, Chelsea and Scott, who are on the rebranding committee. So as I go through this, Chelsea and Scott, if you guys have items that you want to add in your experience to the process, the group last met in late July, and I just have a couple of updates of what came out of that meeting and then where we're going for the board and for everybody this evening. So when we look at where we are right now, so this is about Chris Casabeca. So last year we had a shared, Chris Casabeca and Brody together worked with us on branding and communication. Chris is taking over as just communication, and part of that role will be lifting the branding as well. So Brody still works for BOCES, we can still utilize him, but Chris will be full-time with us like he was last year, but he's doing communications and the branding piece so that he can focus on both aspects. And we're going to talk a little bit about how, as we move into the branding phase, we're going to be partnering with a third party. So the utilization of Brody wouldn't be necessary because we're not going to be using that arm of BOCES anymore. We're going to be using what I'm going to share with you in just a moment, potentially, depending on where the committee goes.
Just to clarify, Chris remains a BOCES employee in his contract. We're contracting with him.
Yep.
I have this full-time position.
He's the same kid. We're at the same level we were with him last year. He was just splitting it with Brody. Now he's full-time here with us, but contracting through BOCES. So the rebranding team will remain in play. They will meet again in September. We met at the end of July. We need to fill one student role. We have a student who graduated, so we're going to hopefully look for a junior, and Mr. George will help us in that process starting in September. So, whole logo. I submitted to the board an acknowledgement in July that we use a whole logo. This came after suggestions from the branding committee, but also from other districts who had recently gone through the adoption process and the nickname, the logo change. So the idea behind it is that as soon as you transition, which we did in July, you should have a whole logo as soon as possible that doesn't have to include the new mascot, which is what we did, but has something for people to put their hands on. You can say, here's some t-shirts. Here's some, even it's on our letterhead now, right? So the whole logo that the board acknowledged is this logo, that RJ block letter that we've used for years and years, with Cardinals just along the bottom. You will see this most recently. If you walk out on our fields, we've had it painted on the soccer field and on the football field for this year. So in addition, something new for us is trying to, Jeff has been great, Tim has been great, around highlighting some different areas in our district to make the new logo something of a pride point for our district. So when you go out to the football field, you'll see it painted in the middle. Right now, it's just the white outline letters. The red is not filled in yet. And then the soccer field is the same. So this is the whole logo right now. For example, this went out. The branding committee shared it. Then it was communicated in Parent Square. And I've already had Music Boosters reach out with sample t-shirts because they want to do a sale, they do a big sale early in September, October. That really helps boost their revenue, and they want to use this. So they're using it. We're giving t-shirts and lanyards. Our wellness committee is doing lanyards for all staff, and we're doing t-shirts for all staff on the first day back. So everybody will have something new to start the school year that will shift us into this new direction. So this is short term. This logo may stay with us. Like, for example, I was talking to two other superintendents yesterday that have done this. Their whole logo, they kept, and they still use it as one of their options, but then you file in an image to go with it, which is what I'm going to share with in a second, is that the image of what a Cardinal's going to look like is going to be our next phase. Because like everything that we've done through this process, this is not my job to come up with an image that's going to be the Cardinal. It's our job, right? It's our community's job, it's our students' job. So that's the next phase that the branding committee is going to jump into, with feedback from the community like we've been doing through this whole process. So when people say, why didn't we just jump into an image, it's because we want to make sure that everybody has a chance to share so that when they get to a final point, even if the person isn't wholly happy, which I know there's not people wholly happy, that's the case, that they can say, I was heard. or I gave my thoughts to this, and then somebody in community came and said, yeah, but I like that image, and this is why. So that's why we're gonna go through this next phase, which is what's next. Who will design the permanent logo? So there's a lot of companies have reached out since July 2nd, right? Lots of voicemails, lots of calls. We're really trying to keep it global with the companies that I'm gonna share with you tonight. And the goal will be that they will do presentations similar to like we've done in the Capital Project Committee when we did the comparison for Barb and Matt, where we looked at our construction managers. We're gonna do the same similar thing with who's gonna help us potentially with this logo building. So the permanent logo, these are the four companies out of many that have reached out. Many of them we already have relationships with locally or through BOCES. And so here's the four, and then I'll go through each one of them individually quickly just to show folks the direction that we're looking. So Lea Media, BSN Sports, Screen Frame by Bowers, and Image X Graphics. So let's look at each one of them individually. So Lea Media, Lea works with BOCES. Lea does and helps us right now. If you look at the current newsletter that is right out right now, Lea does some of the graphic design on that. She's the one who redesigned our newsletter. She does newsletter design for several other districts, and the example that we have up there is CalMAC. CalMAC does the CalMAC Pulse that you see on the right-hand side there. BSN Sports, we work closely. They work with dozens of districts across the Lake Finger Lakes in Western New York. They specialize in athletics, so we do a lot of our athletic gear with them. They have a team that specializes in school mascots. Mascots, a division of BSN. They can also create jerseys, backdrops, tables, tablecloths, flags, decals, etc. So we already have a relationship with Tim. He is who we work with currently for BSN. Screen Printing by Bowers. Cole Bowers is local in Canandaigua, has worked with RJ in the past, done t-shirts for our elementary recently, has done stuff with local schools, background in branding, logo creation, and public relations. Her company sent us this little design over here. This is what they had sent. This is not our logo. I do not share this. This is not our logo. This is just an idea of what you get when these companies send you stuff. And then Image X, Kirsten, who worked with Waterloo, did Waterloo's rebrand. You can see Waterloo's is here. She also has the ability to print decals and signs, so if we're looking to do things around our building in our district, she can help with that. So those are the four companies that we're going to share who are all locally connected, doing work with other districts in our region, and the branding committee will have all four of them come and present at the September meeting, and then they'll make a recommendation to the board like we've done in the past.
Chris, were these images that they developed? We will own the images.
Yes.
There are no commission to them.
Nope.
So we will own the image.
Yep.
And stop me if you're going to cover this, but are we going to expect that either through Chris or through whoever we hire here, someone will create us a brand guide of sorts that says where and when to use the different images and how to size them and things like that?
Yep. Chris will create a brand guide, like kind of like you see Waterloo has this. This is like what the brand guide starts to look like. And he'll say, you know, this is what we use for letterhead. This is what we use for varsity sports. This is the color guide. We already started that, so we already got the colors.
Here's the color codes and stuff.
Yes.
And because I noticed, I've actually been in situations working with some of the youth teams, or whatever, where like people just throw random, like off of Google, like images at these vendors, and they're like, t-shirts are popping up here and there with all kinds of versions, and it's like, I feel like we could do better than that if we put out the right guidance.
Right, and to Matt's point, to your point, there's always going to be people that are going to try to do that, but to Matt's point, if we own it, they can't use it without asking us. So like the Dollar General can't just pop off. If we decide that this is ours, the Dollar General can't just print something that looks like this without going through us and getting Chris's and mine okay.
Yeah. The other question I had, Chris, is, and I know this is a crazy question, but it's a crazy topic, is that the state does not allow us to use a feather.
Right.
A what? Sorry, I didn't hear you say the what.
The state does not allow us to use a feather.
Oh.
A logo. So has anybody just checked with the state with the Cardinals, and obviously the Cardinals fans feathers?
Yeah. So when we made the decision, we shared the state that, and we have not heard anything back yet, but it takes a long time to hear from them. But I think what Chris was able to decipher was like a standalone feather that,
like the Red Wings, just switch to a standalone feather.
Right, right. So I think for us, the design of like the fur, like what Cal Mac has, is similar. Because Cal Mac had to go away from theirs, but they haven't had to change, and they have a bird that has feathers on it as well. So they haven't, we haven't had that issue. We are double checking. We don't feel like it's going to be a thing, but you never know. You're right, because this is always changing, and it seems to always seems to be a little bit of a moving target. But for now, we have no concern that it's going to be an issue. So that was it. So you guys asked questions as we went. Do Chelsea and Scott, did I leave anything out from either of you from the meeting on July 30th from the team? Any thoughts from the Randy folks that I didn't touch on?
For the next steps of what the brand new is doing.
Is there a goal, like a time frame for what you want to have?
Yeah. I didn't put it on here because that's, it's sometimes hard. It's literally when we talk, but we talk about it as a brand new community that we'd like to, if we can have the presentations in September, make some type of recommendation to the board in October to get with the company early winter, have a logo by end of winter, early spring. The goal, the end goal, is by next summer we have a logo.
Okay. So we're going through this full year with the old logo. So
yes.
So they don't have shirts you can throw away.
Right. Yes. Yep. And I think we have to do what we did last year. We have to do right by our community and by our families and by everybody to say, let's get thought, let's get feedback. Let's. Everybody wants to move quickly into these. And I think last year we did a good job of taking it slow, listening to people, understanding frustrations, concerns, challenges, and then coming out. The goal will be hopefully by, you know, June, July, definitely next school year, have a mascot ready for shirts and youth teams and all of those pieces.
So we're good to share that out with people and
concern
about investing in.
Yep, I think you could tell.
Right now.
Yes. Some people that have talked about, you know, student, how students are involved. So I think that'll definitely be something to talk about with whoever we work with. Is like, what is student involvement look like? You know, the students help with a portion of it once the decision is made on what it's going to look like. But
we might see student art at least inspired.
Right.
Be used as inspiration to something, and they could see, oh yeah, that looks kind of like this one student, you know, idea that got a lot of interest.
Right.
Kind of see the shape.
Yeah. Yep, the inspiration. Yep.
Anything else on that topic? That brings us to section 5, personnel, which we will do by consent agenda. So this is number 5A. Is there anyone that has any concerns about consent agenda?
I have one item just for the board to look at on board docs. It was pointed out that with the medical director, we had the same doc on there twice. So it was the employee doc twice. But if you look now, it'll be the employee doc and the student document. So it should be two separate documents. So just to clarify, before, if you saw it on Friday, it was employee-employee. It was pointed out that we had employee-employee, so we adjusted so it should be employee and student. So that's why it might look different from what you saw on Friday.
Question on that, sir.
No, I just had a question about the title for the assistant club coach, is that the same as modified club coach?
One of the assistant football coaches has been appointed to be the head coach for modified.
put in the contract, it's head football coach and three assistant coaches. So one of them comes along, I know, not in addition. Not appointed, but they made it.
Corey is going to be.
Corey's a modified.
So it says assistant football.
Yes, but he's modified, he's hired as assistant coach, and then one of them is oversight of modified. In addition.
The medical, with, before we go to the person on the board action, I don't see a resolution for the medical director contract. How does that, is there, am I supposed to have a language in it?
No, we put it in the consent agenda.
Whatever, I guess.
So it's an annual contract.
That's fair, but why would I not pick that up? Where is that?
If you go to number 5, consent agenda, it says personnel, and then A, and then B is medical.
Oh, in.
Yes.
Sorry, I'm with you guys. I just want to make sure. So, yeah. I read those, but I don't have a resolution. That's what it looks like to me. Let us tell. You said it's in the personnel one up here.
Yeah, it's in the consent. The medical director is part of the consent agenda, which we approve. And the same motion as.
So everything under number 5. So I don't know if any of you guys had this question. Yeah. It's just because I'm having the mechanics of this. But so what we're going to do is basically we're approving everything within section 5.
Yes.
I guess I'm still working here too. Okay. Very good. So that includes the personnel adjustments in the attachment, as well as the medical director. All right. Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the superintendent of schools, pursuant to education law, approves the consent agenda items as presented. Motion by Amy, and a second from Matt, thank you. All right, all in favor? Aye. Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Very good. Thank you. All right. I promise we'll let you do that faster next time. That moves us to section 6, CSE and CPSE. Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the superintendent of schools, pursuant to education law, approves the CSE, CPSE recommendations regarding student placement as presented. Do we have a motion for that, please? Motion from Chelsea. And a second, Amy, thank you. Do you guys have any questions? We don't have Karen, but we can either get back to this. Yes, Scott? Pretty good. All right. All in favor? Aye. Any opposed? None? Motion carries. Very good. Brings us to section 7. Claims auditor report. Did we have anyone looked at it? Did you have any questions? Okay. And then we can turn it back over to the superintendent for his report.
So before I do my report, I have I'm going to do it as a presentation form tonight. You can just share items, but I wanted to actually do a presentation for the board tonight. I just did want to highlight that recently we had 2 mountains go out in the community and in the district. One, it was our new newsletter, so I hope folks have had a chance to see this. Some great items highlighted in here about the mascot change, websites, our retirements were all listed in here. Great pictures, Chris and his team did an awesome job. Transportation team was highlighted for their purpose goal. Ryan Murphy was highlighted for his split target national competition, and link in there to our Buddy Readers program. So a lot of great stuff for folks in here. So if people have not had copies, we want extra copies, we have it in all of the offices and the district office. And then earlier this week, everybody got a new revamped version of our calendar. So you'll notice that our calendar is now.
How did you get that?
Oh, you didn't get it yet?
No. Today's mail?
Oh, okay. I thought it was today.
Oh, yes.
So I think it went out yesterday. So it should be there today or tomorrow. So our new revamped calendar, we have it in the district offices and business, or in all of our offices. They are in color, so it looks a little bit different. And a big thank you again to the board. As you look on here, one of the things that's great is that the adjustment to Thursday nights, all of our board when you look at this calendar, this is busy. Like, the November is crazy busy, and the board meeting is still a standalone. So thank you for adjusting to that Thursday night, because it really did allow us to not, many of us, to not have to wear two hats. Parent, community member, board member, trying to do all of those things I know is already hard enough, so thank you for that. So look at Tim popping out calendars so you can see that. So
I appreciate that.
Did the newsletter go out at the same time as the calendar?
No.
No, the newsletter went out.
I don't remember. I haven't gotten that.
Was second week in August.
Yeah.
Newsletter was out. No?
I might want to check out that, because I don't think.
Did you get one of these, Scott?
Anybody get
one? Chelsea, have you gotten a newsletter?
No, I did. How did you get a newsletter? Yeah, you did?
Pardon? This week. So I know for me, oftentimes when I found in the last few years, when you all get a, many of you get a letter in the mail, and you're all mailed at the same time. Mine takes an extra day because I'm technically Clifton Springs. So it goes from Shortsville or Manchester over to Clifton and then back to my house. So I don't know. Maybe I'm a day behind you. You need to be a lot.
We also have those in district offices. We don't want to wait for the mail too.
Okay. Very good. All right, you got a presentation?
Yeah, so I just wanted to talk a little bit. The board has seen much of this, but I'll be presenting to staffs, all the different staff groups in the month of September. So opening days, I've done one with our team last year. You will see, remember that everyone's invited to opening days that's able to come. It is, the opening day with staff, excuse me, is November 3rd, 8 a.m. We'll start 7:30, we'll have breakfast. 8 a.m. will be in
September.
September 3rd. What did I say?
November.
Oh, that's my wife's birthday. I'm just stuck in my wife's birthday. September 3rd, excuse me, and we will be in the audit foyer to start at 7:30, and then we'll go into the audit at 8 o'clock. A couple of things that you'll notice about opening days that I do differently and that I've tried to bring our district into is that day is about culture, mindset, celebration, gratitude. That day is not about me sharing a list of goals that we need to accomplish for the year. I will go to individual faculty meetings and do that with principals in September, so I'm not saying that's not important, but I've sat in their seats and I know what that does to people. When you come in and you tell them all the things they need to do, and all they're thinking about is being in their classroom and the fact that summer is ending, it's incredibly overwhelming. So our job in that time is we're going to celebrate new staff. That's going to be one of the things. Jamie's going to do a thing to kick us off as a board. Stephanie's going to come and join us this year and kick us off with PTSA. We're going to celebrate new staff, so Dr. Weller and Tim are going to do all new staff so that we know who these folks are, everyone's in the same room, and we welcome them together as an RJ family. We're going to celebrate years of service at that time as well, so we're going to celebrate all those folks that have been a part of our family for an extended amount of time. We have a special award from PTSA to one of our administrators that's going to be a surprise that day that's very exciting. This morning is about capturing energy and celebrating and gratitude and how we're going to go into the school year and build a culture. So I will not be presenting my goals that morning to them. I will present them to them at individual faculty meetings in September. I will present the blueprint to them in September. But that first day is not the time to do that. So I just want to share that with the board. So if you attend that day, you're going to think, well, they don't know what to do. They will. Their building councils have had that blueprint. The principals have had that blueprint. But that day is about setting the tone. The end of that day at 9:30, if you are able to attend, end of that morning, excuse me, we are going to be going out to the football field and we're going to be doing something new. We're going to be taking a whole staff, 180 plus people, picture on the football field around the new logo. So the board is there and you're welcome to attend. So that when everyone gets their new t-shirt, we walk out, we get around the new logo, and we're going to get a whole staff. We have a drone coming back from BOCES to get a nice image of everybody, all staff out there together to kick off the start of the year that will then go up on our website. So that day is about celebrating. That day is about how we set the tone for the school year of positivity and excitement, not about a task of this is what you're going to do. Accomplishments will be there. Expectations will be there, but not that day. So our mission has not changed. And this will be something that we talk about as we shift the blueprint into the strategic plan, because our strategic plan ends in the spring of 2025. So the group that comes together to look at the strategic plan, we will look at this. We will ask ourselves the question, does this still fit RJ right now, and will this fit RJ in 5 years? Same with our beliefs and core values, which we have a lot of. That's the thing that I'm going to ask us to think about. And you're going to hear me talk about this on opening days. Let's do a couple things really well before we overextend ourselves to do 15 things not so well. I'm not saying we're not doing these things well, but I'm just going to ask us to be reflective of that as we look at this going into the year. So none of these have changed. Student first, excellence, leadership, dignity for all, communication, collaboration, continuous improvement. You will see now, though, the difference. Many of these are aligned in the blueprint with actionable items and things we should be trying to do. Collaboration. We're doing a PK-12 curriculum council. We're doing a PK-12 PD committee. We're doing a district council for the first time. So instead of just saying working together is critical to our success, we're trying to show some application and action. These three have not changed. This one is something we're going to talk about. I'm going to talk about a lot at opening days. It's an acronym we use as a district. It's something we talk about as a feeling or emotion or a value as a district. We need to talk about how we tap into showing it and living it and being it as a district. So that's what I'm going to talk about. But this big one on opening days is pride. So my goals, this is not something new to the board, the district blueprint, which I'll show you, this is a modified version from what the board has seen in the past, or has reviewed last week with me. And this one is one that I will share with staff when we get into the opening days. So vision doesn't change, mission doesn't change. I do want them to have a clear understanding of what the goal of this document is, which this document is a gap document, right? This is to get us through this year as we look at how we revise and come into next year with a strategic plan, because that I shared with many of you. Let's just be transparent. I've held up our strategic plan in meetings with our staff that have never seen that document. And I'm not saying that's against anybody that was here 5 years ago, 7 years ago, 2 years ago. I'm just telling you the facts of what I learned when I was going through this building process. I want them to know that they're going to be a part of the creation of this as we go into the spring as well. We will focus on this approach that we talked about, which is how are we meeting student needs, how are we meeting adult needs, how are we meeting facility needs. This is what I'm talking about when I say how do we simplify our beliefs and our values. How do we make them things that are obtainable and things that aren't just kind of like pie in the sky. Measuring success. This is the questions that we need to continue to ask ourselves. These are the answers that we're working on. We just received some additional data today regarding state data and regions data. So these are the things that we have to ask ourselves. How do we define and how will we consistently measure quantitative measurements and qualitative measurements? What tools or tools and how often will we measure? These are the drives that I'm giving the principals and Dr. Weller so that we can have this built out going into the school year. How will we adjust and learn when we're reviewing these things? Just like we've committed to as a board and as a leadership team to looking at the blueprint, our staff can continue to look at data throughout the school year to ask about how we're impacting student learning. And then a big one that I think we often miss, and I miss this, like I will be the first person to say this, I tend to go to the next, I attack the next need when we need to remind ourselves. And I say this to a leadership team all the time, remind me to celebrate. I said to you guys at our retreat, like, I need to get better at celebrating the incredible work that our leadership team has done in the last 16 months. Instead of telling them, guys, this is what we need to do next. So you've seen these are the priorities. So what I've done, instead of having 7 priorities, we're streamlining it for the staff, you're going to see now 3 priorities that have 3 titles that are all linked to high-level topics. So priority 1 is going to be a focus on culture. Maintain and build community school pride is the initiative. Create and sustain positive district culture is the initiative. Recruitment and retention of high-quality staff is one of the initiatives. So not a million initiatives under each point. Now, does it get busier as we work our way to the right? Yes, because that's when we start to talk about action. So what are we currently doing? And then future worker, what are things that staff can expect to start to see this coming soon? Priority 2, set up exactly the same, again, but just 2 points of focus now, which is engagement and collaboration. Two points that have been constantly talked about for the last 16 months. So initiative one is student engagement, meeting the unique of all, the unique needs of all students. I've had many conversations with board members around this. Like, how are we making sure that we have pathways for students? So in there, you'll see that we've written that down by current work, but then also future work, right? And people think, well, there's only a couple things under future work. MTSS, anybody that knows this, Amy probably knows it, is huge. It is enormous. That is a multi-year undertaking. That's why that stands at the top, solo like that, because that is going to be, MTSS stands for multi-tiered systems of support. And that's something that we're trying to build, which is multi-tiered systems of support. And now, this does not, people go right in their mind to SEL or mental health. MTSS is not just that. It's part of it, but it's also academics, it's also rigor, it's also looking at data, it's also looking at pathways for student success. All of that follows under that multi-tiered systems of support. Collaborative decision making. This has been a huge request from our staff, and you'll see, what are we currently doing? We're doing things that we're trying to continue to build that collaboration. But on the right-hand side, we were clear to point out that there are three big new initiatives that are coming this school. A PD committee to get staff involved in the engagement, what the professional development they need, and how to make it consistent and sustainable. A district council that will have oversight, not in a micromanagement way, but in a collaborative and consistent way with our building councils. And then a curriculum council that will set up a process to really look at how at Red Jacket do we analyze our current curriculum, update our current curriculum, adopt new curriculum. Now the last priority, you see again trying to simplify for folks but not lose the meaning, is safety and support. So safety and security, we talk about what are we currently doing. We're trying lots of ways to maintain safety and security in our building or build safety and security. Then the future work, things that we have to continue to think about. We have to think about how we budget to maintain an SRO. How do we use our budget to make sure that we do updates as we can to our general budget, but then also how do we use our facility resources through capital project planning. Training of staff is huge. Not just the vector training, but are we having hands-on conversations with our staff? And subs came up specifically from our teaching staff, which is incredibly important, so that they know what they're doing, and they understand in an emergency how to respond for our students and for themselves. And then one thing that we've added, and this is something that you guys I think have seen as a wrinkle that I've heard, that I feel like I think is really important, is are we getting our leaders trained consistently and updated consistently? So Karen, John, so a member of the district each year will be at the NYSED Safety Summit, because there's so much information shared there each year. It's free. All we have to do is get them down there, get them a night, and then get them back. And it's two full days of learning with other districts and many professionals within the safety field about how to stay updated in this time.
Is
it
going
to
be the same person? Like, doesn't Karen do a lot of work with that?
So Karen went this year. Karen and I went this year. I think the goal was going to be, John couldn't go last year, that's why I went. The goal would be for Karen and John to go this year. And then the year after that, we're thinking maybe Karen and Jeff, because then we'll be in the midst of that capital project. So
Karen, as
Karen will be the main, yes. Karen will be consistent, and then we'd like to send other folks, and maybe it's a building principal. I'd love to have a teacher rep come from our safety team. You know, somebody who may not know when we get that opportunity. And then SEL. So TIG is under future work, because Wayfair looks both the TIG is for trauma, illness, and abuse. How do we respond to challenges? And how do we prepare for challenges? We purchased a little bit more because they came out off of a new consortium for TIG, and we are a part of the new consortium. So we have some new offerings that will offer some new training for staff, that will offer some new training for our leadership team, Karen, myself, around how to support staff proactively and reactively. You'll see one other one here that I wanted to point out is EAP, came up over and over, which is the Employee Assistance Program. Like the acronyms that we live in are absolutely mind-blowing.
No different than any other organization.
Yeah, it's insane. But So EAP is Employee Assistance Program. But I just go back to you guys, because if you don't know what it's saying, you're like, what does that one stand for? But EAP is Employee Assistance Program. We, Tim, did great work last spring after it came out that people weren't totally satisfied with our current EAP because it maybe didn't offer as much as they were looking for. So for a little shift financially, we have new EAPs coming in. Tim just sent the communication yesterday or today?
Early today.
And they're going to be doing some onboarding in the early part of the year to show some really new and different layers and offerings that they offer to staff, from things of like fiscal management for staff and how to help staff with that, from marriage counseling to I just need someone to talk to, or like lots of different avenues for staff. Both unions, both the RJFA and CSEA, had spoken to this being something they would like to have more understanding and better offering, so we wanted to offer that to them this year. CCT, you're going to hear too, is a new one, and this is a new one that Karen does. It's a critical care team, and that is just the name of all of our psychs, just our psychs in-house, psychs, counselors, and she's added nurses, and now Karen has shifted her responsibilities a bit, so she has oversight of that group. The principals still do their observations and have the day-to-day with them, but Karen does a K-12 umbrella with them. She's meeting with them, I believe, once a month, but then also meeting with the principals once a month to talk more about our K-12 development of our counseling program, our social emotional program, how we're utilizing a new social worker, all of those things that we've developed in the last 12 to 16 months.
That's what I was gonna say. I think the social worker's on the team.
Yes, I forgot that social worker. Yep. So Tricia is on that team, as well as the nurses was an addition this year, which I appreciated Karen bringing to the team.
I saw a nice parent square announcement.
Yes.
I thought it was really great. Listed out the different roles that were all part of that initiative and things. So
Chris, how do you arrange the schedule? So if you're adding more things in, how are they compressing that into their normal?
So a lot of folks have asked about, well, why? Where did the shift in the 2:15 time come? The 2:30 release time for students. So the middle school now has a release at 2:30 as well. Students can stay if they need to, have to, or are required to, but that will loosen up a lot of staff from that 2:30 to 3:15 time, because contractually 6:12 is here until 3:15. Elementary already has that time built in the morning because they come at 8:15 to 8:20. They have about 30 minutes in the morning, but we couldn't find a good time for 6:12. Now we do have that naturally built in a little bit easier. It's going to be more relaxed. And you know what we have to do too? Sometimes we have to make people stay. Sometimes we have to offer people, you know, summertime. But there's an expense to the district, right? That's not free. Is anything outside of the contractual day, we're compensating people for that time. All right. So that was my first goal. I know that took a minute, but did anybody have any questions around blueprints? Again, this is going to be my job in September will be to go to faculty meetings and share this with faculty, with the building principals in collaboration to talk about the direction for the next 10 months. So the other goal the board is aware of is the title is kind of wonky, but I took it because it's off of super eval, so I wanted the board to see the direct feedback. Was this came as one of my areas of improvement on super eval, so it was relationship with BOEs where it falls. It doesn't mean that I think board and I have a bad relationship. It just fell under that hierarchy area. And it was district policy review, very much trying to align with what the board has outlined, which is review and hearing with BOCES, discuss and organize the policy to review process during BOE work sessions for the 24-25 school year, create a review calendar, establish a sustainable process to maintain policy for future years. Very aligned with the board. Professional knowledge, this is something that I think is incredibly important to the role that I play with our district. I need to be an advocate, I need to be a learner, and I need to be a voice, and these are the ways that I'm trying to do that. Some of them are new. So this, just to explain to folks, Wade Finger Lakes has committees within the 25 superintendents. The executive committee is one that you're asked to be on. There are 7 superintendents that represent the 25 superintendents, so I'm one of them. The legislative committee is one that works directly with legislation. So we go to all meetings, we have conversations with, we invite folks to us. We meet, Jamie Farr is a big member of this from Canandaigua, so we meet often with the county executives, we meet with FLCC to do partnerships and conversations. That all runs through that committee with Wayne Fairless. YMCA board is a new one for me this year. I just started that this summer, so I'm on the YMCA board. I'm also on the ARC board. Lynn Ertl, who many of you know, Lynn has been a long-standing member of that board and has asked me to come on. She's retired, so I'll be taking Lynn's place. That started last spring, but I'll keep going. Great connection when we talk about some of the resources that ARC does that we're not even aware of. Like, I don't know about you guys, maybe I'm not, but I didn't know they had a coffee shop in downtown Canandaigua that's run by the ARC and by their students. They have a pet boutique in the same area where they do dog care and they do haircuts, and all with ARC employees and students who are working with the ARC program are running and working inside these two different organizations. So I learned a lot just in my first couple of months with them.
Is that the impact?
Yes. Yeah. And Red Jacket Rotary and Red Jacket Lions are both that I've been a part of. Lions, I do also, just so that folks always ask the question, I do try to attend at least 2 for the ladies' Lions a year as well. I go to them. Those are way quicker. No offense.
But that was fun.
No, the entertainment level is different. I always drag Tim to at least 1 or 2 of these a year to help come do some budget presentations. So he went to Rotary with me last year a couple times. He went to both Lions clubs with me. At the state level, I am a member of the New York State Council of Superintendents. Obviously, that's what I traveled with this summer. I do attend the September conference with them, and then I am presenting at the March conference this year about my trip, which is below here, which I'll be sharing with the board in September. And then I'm also an AASA member and representation. Personal, this is one that I have to put in there because I say to all of the leadership team, when you sit down with me and you make a goal, the last goal, or one of those goals, I tell them no more than 5 goals. One of those goals needs to be something about you as a human being. You as a person, not you as a principal, not you as a director of transportation, you as a person. Like, I wanna read more books. I don't care what it is, but each month when I meet them, I ask them about all of them, and I always end with this one. I always talk about, where are we with this? And mine is a constant struggle, right? Like, depending on the month, don't ask my wife about this goal, because there's months where it's just not good, but it's something that I need to be thoughtful of and continue to try and focus on, so that's why I do it, because I think it's important that when I present this to staff, I'm a model for what I know many of them also struggle with.
I don't know how this goes with all your memberships and...
What makes a week do you even...
I know, are you at home?
You find the balance. My wife's a champ, she is. Questions from the board? Again, this is something that I will be presenting with them and with a full staff.
She's a saint.
She's a saint.
Yeah.
She is a saint.
No, I really appreciate the leadership that you're taking, especially with the personal goal, and setting that standard as a leader so that everyone can prioritize themselves too. It's great.
And I'll share in my Friday update, or weekly update, I try to stick to Friday, but sometimes it goes to Saturday, but in my weekly update, just for Jen, because this is still new, I try to just recap much of what board meeting things, if there's questions, if there's things that come up, and I always try to reshare presentations, because it's a lot to try to consume so that people can see them, and if they have follow-up questions, I try to do that all in that weekly update.
Fortunately, a lot of the content is also in Word docs.
Yes.
Not everything necessary.
Yep, it is. Yep, only thing that's not in there. And I will, just like the board, I think, will eventually do, I don't know, but I will, you guys can talk about it. I will post my goals on the website.
Yeah.
So I'll do the same thing, so that folks can see those.
I think our goal is to finalize and present in September. So we'll have some communication back and forth about any edits to our goals.
And I'm September 12th.
Yeah, that's true. So, well, let's,
yeah.
appreciate and give credit to us as a board for setting goals and being a little beautiful this year. We can all agree that there's a lot of great depth. And hopefully measurability, and I'm sure we'll see updates. All right, let's keep this show on the road here. The next item under reports and correspondence will be community updates. Now, we have already touched on branding. I think you guys got an update. Are there any updates from the Capital Project Committee?
They were going to take our document and put it together, and then you could talk. I'm unsure of the dates. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. So what they were doing, they were going to take what the committee prioritized and put pricing, real more specific pricing, to give some prices, which we haven't received from John Paul Watchdog yet. Tim can give an update on it from his perspective in a second, but that's where we kind of ended it, was that I would email. We were going to do an August meeting because John Paul and Watchdog said they need time to figure this out. So once they have those numbers, we'll share that with the committee, which would tell us where are we with the cap on our project. Are we there? Do we have some space to try to do something more? Do we need to peel back to communicate to? But that will be the next step. And then the next step for us as a district is we'll start doing our, go ahead.
I was just going to piggyback on that. Watchdog and SCI obviously represent a lot of districts, and a lot of capital projects happen in the summer, so right now they're trying to get a lot of districts to the finish line. So they have been working on their numbers, but that's not a priority right now. So beginning and middle of September, we'll meet and start to narrow down those numbers. October is the October board meeting are two big dates in terms of capital project, and that we will have to do the seeker for the capital project, as well as a bond resolution. Once we know the amount of the project, how much we anticipate needing to finance. And I think the board knows this, but we're looking at a December, sometime in December vote. So that's where it has to be 45 days before the vote. So that's where those October deadlines come from.
Are you guys able to share some examples of some of the things that were on top of the priority list? Just out of curiosity.
Probably shouldn't until they...
you guys tell me what is appropriate to share or not.
I think I'll wait until we have it finalized from the cost, because I wouldn't want to say something now and ask that the committee
to come back. Expect it to hand.
Yes.
In general, it's more infrastructure.
Right. And I think maybe by the September meeting, if we have more solid numbers, I think we'd be comfortable sharing that we know that we're being under and not having to cut something.
Cool. I think we can also share, I think Matt might have said this before. Right now, we are doing a smaller, but it's about the size of our biggest capital project right now, and then we anticipate next year another capital project which might get to more of our wish list items that the community's talking about, but we didn't want to rush that decision. We wanted to take another full year to make what the best direction to go for that would be for the district.
Right, and to that point, I've talked to the committee about this at length. The committee was great because as we went through the process last spring and last summer, this summer, I made it clear to them that I'm still continually to grow concerns on this upcoming year, being an election year, being the fact that foundation aid is being looked at. So that's when we came back and said, okay, so we can do a smaller but still big project that can focus on things that are really responsible things that will help the sustainability of the district. So they were great about prioritizing some things that may not be the flashy things, but we wanted to be responsible because we want to make sure that if we did go after a flashier item, that we weren't coming back to the community and saying, well, we did this, but now we have to pull back X, Y, and Z.
Great update, thank you. Okay, that moves us then to financial reports. There's a treasurer's report, account balances and such. Any questions on that? Okay, I will go ahead and accept that on behalf of the board. Next up, 8B, fixed asset salvage. You guys take a look, there's buses on there. And then some other nice uniforms and stuff.
I have one comment just for the board.
Sure.
So one of the items that is in there are old jerseys that have the Indian symbol. So Tim and I are in conversations with our legal team. We're looking at an opportunity to potentially, we would still vote to salvage them, but once we salvage them, save them and auction them. That's one of the things we're looking at, because we're continuing, this is gonna continue to come up for the next couple of months. And we would take those, it would give people the opportunity to have them, and it would also be a way for us to maybe potentially put some funds into our extra classroom activity fund. But we would still salvage them, so the board would still accept that, but then instead of actually salvaging them, we'll save them, and we're trying to figure
instead
out
instead of throwing them in the trash. I mean, yes. They've been salvaged from a financial standpoint.
Yes.
And then we still hold the items.
Yes.
They might do something.
We're going to try to find the best. Tim's in conversation with some of the other business officials that are doing this, who have done the grant, and
just,
then we're going to try.
Just FYI, years ago, Dominic Finnecourt was coaching in AD. They used to salvage all the jerseys every other year.
Yep.
They would donate, because they're salvaged, they would, Booster Club would take possession of it, and then they would resell it to players. And then they would make that money, the Booster Club would make a donation to buy new jerseys.
Gotcha.
So basically, we're getting new jerseys at no cost.
Gotcha. Yeah. So we're looking at a process to try to make sure that people have asked about that, those items too, so if folks ask, please let them know that we're looking at ways that would potentially allow them that access.
So there's another, just one more comment. I hate to say it, but I'm not Sydney, for example, up there, that's one example. So they used to, the jerseys that are hanging up over high school, that student used to get that jersey for that college.
Yeah.
As we're getting rid, right, I know there's at least two that didn't. Is that an opportunity where there's a football player that has a something hanging, a track star that has something hanging that should get a jersey as a recognition?
Yeah.
I have a question. I don't know if this is stupid enough. Is this treading on ground that we shouldn't be? If we're going to give these Indians back to the community,
well,
and
so
then they come
to
back
well,
to the school with an
say,
Indian
it,
on
it?
I mean,
say it does. Some of them do have the logo, and some of them do have the
yeah, but I mean, aren't we getting...
But again, it goes back to what I've wanted to make clear. The state education department can tell the district what to do, but they can't tell the town or the community what to do. Right?
Individual.
Right. Like, if someone showed up here with a Redskins jersey on, Washington Redskins, I can't tell them what to wear that jersey. And this is the
business. Yes.
It's, right. It's, and that's the individual person.
This is what Canada would do.
Yep. Canada, Waterloo, Tomac.
It becomes more of a historical artifact, right? If you want to have that as a memento, that's fine. I mean, that's pride.
Yep.
In what,
but I did ask that question. Era.
Yeah.
That's what popped right in my brain. And I called
legally,
the
I just
called two of the superintendents and said, what did you do? Is this? And they both said, yes. We need
I mean, the state with that stipulation on it say they're going
to
withhold aid if we don't do
right.
this, and then we're going to let the community come in with all these Indians on
it. Said these
I think we're going to discourage people from wearing older branded gear. I mean, they could still choose to.
Yes.
That.
Just
yeah.
wondered. I would just.
Yeah. No, but we did look into that. I did, but that was the first thing before we even brought it.
As long
to
as
this.
We're not legally responsible.
Yeah.
All right. I don't have resolution text here. Do you want to need some? I mean, I can go on the fly. But.
Yeah, go ahead and motion. I think there's two actions on the next one, so I might have got here. Put down there.
At the recommendation, do you want me to?
Yeah.
Basically, at the recommendation of the superintendent, the Board of Education approves. Fixed asset salvage according to the attachment. I'll just clarify, there's four total line items, three buses, and an athletics line item. So, a motion for Chelsea.
Second.
A second for Jen. Any further questions? We just had a discussion with you guys.
We're
going to
hold you on this
I think we're going to put all of it. If we get the green light, we're going to go and we're going to try to find a way to be able to make it equitable. That was my other thing, Jen, was like, we can't do one thing and not the other.
Chris,
that's
actually
works.
I have a question.
Scoreboards only have panels on them that should have been removed.
this item number four, quite honestly. Like, it just says banner uniform scoreboards. I mean, if you're talking about big, I mean, I see that when we talk about like miscellaneous, you know, uniform shirts and stuff. I mean, you get a scoreboard with an asset tag, do we need to specifically salvage that?
It's a bad word. It's like a portable, it's like a flip scoreboard. Not any of the big scoreboards.
Oh.
I should have attached her list in the confidential part.
Do you have a more specific list somewhere?
Yes.
Would you mind following up? I think we're okay to approve this, but maybe not because we want to poke holes in it, but just for reference, so we can look up there. Okay. All right. Any further? You guys good with that? Okay.
But those panels, are they translucent or can you just flip them around backwards?
They are literally the ones that said Indians, not the logo, are unscrewed. And the Indian head, I'm talking about the middle gym, I think needed a little elbow grease to get up, to get it off, so it's not a panel, but we're not getting rid of the whole scoreboard. It's easily with a little elbow grease taken off. And that's the only two that I think, even though they were in the last capital project somehow, got put in there 2 times ago. The rest do not have an image or the Indians on it.
All right. With respect to the fixed asset salvage, all in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Not. Motion carries. So we're going to go there. Okay. Tax levy, item 8C. The board hereby accepts the recommendation of the superintendent to set the 2024-2025 tax levy at $8,161,056. Motion. Motion from Matt.
Second.
Second from Jen. Thank you. Okay. I mean, obviously, we've been through a long budget process. Are there any additional questions here? Okay, very good. All in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. 8D, non-resident tuition rate. Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the superintendent of schools, and pursuant to education law, approves the out-of-district tuition rates for the 2024-2025 school year. Chelsea and second from Scott, thank you very much. You guys obviously have the rates are kind of written there in board docs and there's an attachment. Did this change much from prior year, Tim? I can't remember.
The state comes out with a number, and the last 2 years it's been about 50% what it used to be, just because our American Rescue Plan money has been used to fund a lot of money in a lot of districts, so the tuition rates were about twice as high 2 years ago. We anticipate next year maybe not going up back to double that amount, but pretty close to it.
It's half of the amount to go to McQuaid.
And as I said in the video, we had a student that graduated that was paying tuition, and now we have a kindergartner coming in paying tuition. So we do have people interested in paying to come to the district.
Any other further questions on that? All right. With respect to the out-of-district tuition rates, all in favor? Aye. Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Thank you. We're getting there, you guys. A couple more to go. New business. This is an amendment to the superintendent's employment agreement. Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the superintendent of schools, and pursuant to education law, approves the amendment to the superintendent's agreement. Obviously, personnel related, so we don't have to have a good question, but you've all had to inform and have the documentation. Are there any particular questions here that we could address? Okay, very good. Wait, did I already take a motion? No, can I get a motion, please? Sorry. Chelsea, thank you. I'll get there. And Amy, thank you very much. All right. All in favor? Aye. Any opposed? None. And I just want to take a moment to say that I'm sure that we all have said similar things over time. A lot of gratitude for Superintendent Bernard, and we've had a fantastic start to his tenure here at Red Jacket. Grateful for all that you've done in your first year here with us. We saw the goals. There's a lot of the docket for this year. For the good of this district, so thank you. All right, and item 9C is questions, hopefully get the big ones there together in the hands of the superintendent so he's ready. But let's go ahead and get the resolution on deck here. So,
we should be doing the athletic department.
I'm sorry. That's my fault. 9B, keep me out, it's fair enough. I don't even see, in this particular arrangement, I don't see what's up there. Maybe that would have helped me last time, or this time.
Yes.
Next time, I'm going to go ahead. Although I'm doing pretty good here. Okay. All right. So, mergers. Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools and pursuant to education law, approves the athletic department mergers. This is an additional opportunity for girls tennis. So, can I get a motion real quick? Matt, awesome. Second. Amy, great. You guys read a doc from Shannon explaining here. Any other questions? Cool. All in favor? Aye. Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Now on to the handbooks. Board of Education, upon the recommendation of the Superintendent of Schools and pursuant to Ed Law, approves the Athletics and Extracurricular Activities Handbook, APPR Plan, RTI Plan, and Code of Conduct. Any other motion?
Can I just make two quick comments about that?
Yeah.
So, first one is just a reminder, the Code of Conduct was a basic carryover because we're doing Code of Conduct review this year. And as you see, I think in the news, the timing is right to have conversations around some big ticket items like cell phone uses in school and, going all the way down the path. The other thing with the athletic extracurriculars activity handbook that we're going to have to be thoughtful of, if you're watching the news, there's a lot of conversations right now around Title IX that we have to keep our eye on and how that might be a policy change for us, but also impact our athletic clothing. And I bring that up because maybe bring that back to the table at some point mid-year if something comes to fruition with the current Title IX scenario that is out there. The APPR plan, a board member emailed, and it was great, asking about dates, because the date at the top was wrong, so we adjusted the date. The names that are in the APPR plan are people, some of them do not work in the district anymore, some of them are retired, but that is because that document, just to explain to the board, is a state approved from NYSED from 2021. We will be revisiting that document because, as many of you know, APPR is now being adjusted. When we revisit that document, then those names will change. But because that is a state document that is on, that goes to NYSED and is actually on the portal, the folks that created it maintain their names on it until we adjust the document, which will probably be coming in the next couple of years as we learn more about the APPR adjustments. So, because that does come up with why it is so-and-so who retired 2 years ago is still on there because it was created in 2021.
So, quick question for you, so I can put you on the spot. So you got a good question about those docs. We've talked about as a board, like, hey, let's make sure that if a question is asked, everyone gets the answer. So is that kind of your, in your mind, the idea was bring that to the table for this?
Yes.
Right now, here's the here, everyone gets that.
Yep.
I think, I don't know, it'd be interesting for the board to think about, like, it might have been nice to get, I don't know if you responded to where everyone gets the question.
Yeah.
If that goes out like, via email, that information is being provided, I think it'd be nice to get everyone. I'm not trying to be critical, I'm just throwing it out there. I think it's a fair question.
I just
some things are more important than others, to get that answer out. It might preempt questions that do come up from others.
Yeah.
Thanks. I just want to make sure that I do a good job of that. I wanted to note that when I started reviewing the materials and I saw the extracurriculars handbook 2019 and 2024, and I thought, oh my god, am I going to have to open both of these up to try to figure out what's changed? And then I saw that there was a document called Handbook Changes.
Yeah.
It was phenomenal.
Yes.
But not only did it say, here's what it was and here's what it is, it gave a little brief reasoning. Loved it.
Yes.
She
asked me about that.
Keller, great job. Anytime you have stuff like that, whether it's athletics or not, when you can get that summary, it's really good. I know it takes time.
Oh, okay. That's good.
Okay. Great, so can we get a motion? So this is with respect to approving these plans, already read the resolution.